This audio recording was produced in 2014 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition recorded by arrangement with Multnomah Books, an imprint of Crown Publishing Group, a division of Random House, LLC. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles.
Tempered Steel: How God Shapes a Man's Heart Through Adversity. Multnomah Drive Time Audio is proud to present Tempered Steel, read by the author, Steve Farrar.
America has been built on steel. Without steel, there would be no railroads to crisscross the nation with freight, no interstate highway system to speed us to Grandma's house for Thanksgiving, no cars to speed us along those interstates, and no great river-spanning dams to generate electricity for our homes. The uses of steel are almost beyond imagination. Generally speaking, steel is an alloy of iron and carbon. You can't have steel without iron. Iron itself is an alloy. There is a formula for making iron, a recipe. It has been said that making iron is something like baking a cake. The key ingredient in that cake, the flour, if you will, is iron ore. And into that iron ore, you stir coke, limestone, air, and water. This recipe is cooked in a blast furnace that can be as high as 15 stories and achieves temperatures up to 3,000 degrees. The intense heat causes the raw materials to melt together. The melted iron, freed from impurities, trickles down to the lowest part of the furnace. The slag containing the impurities floats on top of iron that's 4 to 5 feet deep. It takes incredible heat to make iron. But in order to get steel, you need even more fire and even more heat. Steel is stronger than iron, but also flexible and can be shaped into a number of various products. There are a number of methods to make steel. One method requires an open hearth furnace, a structure the size of a two-story house, producing temperatures in excess of 3,000 degrees. It is significant that each batch of steel made in a furnace is called a heat. Another method is the Bessemer method. The Bessemer converter is an open-topped, egg-shaped furnace that can be tipped on its side. As air is blown into the converter at high pressure, flames shoot into the air with a tremendous roar. These flames reach as high as 30 feet and can be seen for miles at night. The temperatures in the Bessemer method reach up to 3,500 degrees. Needless to say, there is no steel without fire and heat. Since the 1850s, some of the most famous steel in the world was Bethlehem steel. The plants in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, roared night and day, producing quality steel that found its way all over the world. There was no better steel to be found anywhere than Bethlehem steel. That small town in the hills of Pennsylvania was known all over the world for the steel that came out of its mills. I would suggest to you that there is another kind of Bethlehem steel. This steel doesn't come from the hills of Pennsylvania, but from a village in the hills just below Jerusalem. It is the steel of soul produced in the lives of men and women who bow to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, who was born in Bethlehem. The Lord Jesus Christ not only saves men, He makes and forms men. It is the desire of the Father to conform us into the image of His Son. And like the steel produced in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, so the tempered steel that God desires to produce in our lives, strong, sure, and flexible, involves tremendous heat and fire. The Lord Jesus Christ, born as the God-man in Bethlehem, existed before He was born and placed in a manger. He has always existed. It was He who spoke the worlds into existence. And it was in His Father's plan that 1,000 years before the son would be born to a virgin, another young man would roam the hills of Bethlehem. David, too, was born in that little village in the hills. It was God's desire to take this youngest son of Jesse and shape him into a man that could be used for God's glory. There is a process recorded for us in the life of David and in the Psalms. It is the story of a man who is well acquainted with the searing heat of long adversities. Throughout his story, you see his impurities coming to the surface. And the reason he was familiar with heat and fire was that God wanted to use him. God wanted to temper him, just as God desires to temper us. There is a process in making steel, and there is a process God uses to make a godly man. They are very similar. Do you find yourself in the fire? Do you find yourself in deep pain as your hopes and dreams are burned up before your eyes? You should know that your hardship is not by chance. It is by design, a sovereign design. The God who created you and chose you has something very unique for you to do. But first he must purify you, allowing the slag to come to the top where it can be skimmed away. That can only occur in the flames and heat of adversity. That may not be a popular message, but it is a true message. All is not lost if you find yourself in the fire. God is simply getting you ready to fulfill the purpose for which you were created. As you will hear in the pages that follow, you're not alone in those crushing circumstances. You're not by yourself in that furnace. As a matter of fact, you're in the very best of company. Chapter 1, Trapdoors and Pit Stops. There are two ways to get a hotel named after you. The first approach is to own the place. If you can scare up the cash to buy or build a hotel, then you have the right to slap your name over the door. Conrad Hilton built Hilton hotels around the world. J. Willard Marriott did the same thing with his Marriott chain. That's the first way to get a hotel named after you. The second method doesn't require cash, it requires greatness. There is a hotel in Jerusalem that is the hotel in Israel, and one of the great hotels in all of the world. This hotel has been the meeting place of diplomats and CEOs from every corner of the planet. Under its roof, three different governments in exile have headquartered themselves at various times throughout the 20th century. Just last fall, in a single evening, an incoming president of the United States, two former presidents, the U.S. Secretary of State, and a number of former secretaries of state, the Prime Minister of Britain, the heir to the British throne, the King and Queen of Jordan, and the President of Egypt were all sleeping under its roof. I do not refer to the Jerusalem Red Roof Inn. This elite and prestigious establishment is known as the King David Hotel. When David was a teenager, minding his father's sheep in the hills around Bethlehem, he had no idea that one day, 3,000 years in the future, the leaders of the world would stay in a great inn just a few miles away that would bear his name. But that's precisely what happened. David went through some major transitions to get from the obscurity of being a shepherd to the throne of Israel. Everyone goes through transitions. Change is part of life. You've been through it, and so have I. So let's be honest about it. Some transitions are tougher than others. The toughest transitions are what I call trapdoor transitions. Have you ever seen an old movie where some character falls through a trapdoor in the floor? He's walking through some winding castle hallway, minding his own business, when he steps on a portion of the floor and, whew, suddenly he disappears, plunging into some dark, cobwebby tunnel or dungeon. Maybe you've experienced something similar in your life. Your world seems to be spinning along in normal fashion. You're going about your affairs just like you do every day, and then, bam, all of a sudden there's thin air between you and where the floor ought to be. You know exactly what I'm talking about, don't you? You've experienced the trap doors, and so have I. Totally unforeseen and completely unexpected, trap doors have a way of radically changing your life in the blink of an eye. That's what happens when the bottom falls out. We remember Winston Churchill as perhaps the greatest prime minister in the history of Great Britain. By the steel of his will, he led his island nation to stand against Hitler and eventually triumph in World War II. But years before that victorious moment for the ages, Churchill found himself plunging through a succession of devastating trapdoors, each one worse than the last. In August of 1929, Churchill had managed to bring in approximately $70,000 into the family coffers. That's a lot of money even today. In 1929, it was an unimaginable amount for a single month's work. He invested nearly all of that money in the American stock market. He then jotted a note off to his wife saying how pleased he was to finally reach a place of financial independence. Less than 90 days later, the stock market fell through its own trapdoor, and Churchill lost virtually everything. It was a major blow. Churchill had experienced 90 days of financial security, and then the bottom fell out. For the first time in his adult life, he'd been on Easy Street, enjoying the prospects of a comfortable future, and then, bam, the trapdoor fell open beneath his feet, and down he went. That setback alone would be enough to send most any man deep down into the dungeon of depression. But there were two more trapdoors that waited quietly and patiently for Churchill to arrive. In 1931, after serving his entire adult life as a central figure in the British government, he was not invited to serve in the cabinet. This was another staggering blow to Churchill. He had been banished to the political wilderness. While Hitler was working full-time to build his war machine, Churchill, virtually the only British politician who saw the reality of Hitler's threat, was put out to pasture. When he should have been on center stage, he was banished to his country home where he wrote, painted, built brick walls, and cleaned out ponds to keep himself busy. The great statesman was sent down to the minors to play Class A ball when he should have been starting in the All-Star game. This defeat was even more bitter than his great financial loss. It was heating up in that British steel furnace. And then in the same year, while he was trying to hold things together financially and fight off the depression of political defeat, he decided to take a tour of Canada and the United States. In New York City, he looked the wrong way before crossing a street and was hit by a taxi traveling at about 35 miles an hour. The accident sent him to the hospital, clinging to his life by a thread. In less than 3 years, he had suffered three shattering trapdoor transitions, devastating him financially, then politically, and then in an accident that nearly cost him his life. In a letter to their son from the hospital, his wife wrote, "Last night he was very sad and said he had now, in the last 2 years, had three very heavy blows. First, the loss of all that money in the crash, the loss of political position in the Conservative Party, and now this terrible injury. He said he did not think he would ever recover completely from these three events." At that point, as he convalesced in that New York hospital room, Churchill was 57 years old. Eventually, he did recover from all three trapdoors. 9 years later, at just the right moment in history, the government that had ignored him would turn to him in desperation. But he couldn't see that future as he lay in that hospital bed. All he could see were the three trapdoors that had nearly taken everything away from him. In fact, Churchill's prospects looked so dismal at that moment that one of his enemies was emboldened enough to pronounce a political eulogy. "Churchill," he said, "is finished." Famous last words. History proved that statement to be just a tad premature. Perhaps like Churchill, you've experienced some devastating losses and reversals. You feel like the heat and stress from a dozen pressing circumstances are slowly bending you out of shape. And the thought has crossed your mind that you will never be able to recover. There might even be some critics who are writing you off as finished, and you're beginning to think they may be right. Trap doors can do that to a man. Those sudden, floor-dropping moments can take away our finances, our careers, and even our health. They can take away our carefully laid plans and strategies. They can rob us of our marriages and our most important friendships. That's precisely why trapdoor transitions are so devastating. But God is bigger than the trapdoors that suddenly send us into free-fall dives without a parachute. To be quite honest about it, those trap doors are there by His design and with His permission. That statement may puzzle you and even confuse you. It deserves some backup, and I promise you we'll get to that very soon. But we left David back with the sheep, and to understand what is happening in your life, we need to take a quick scan of the trapdoor transitions that sent David's life reeling. Like Churchill, David was no stranger to sudden reversals. The events of David's life have been chronicled for us in the book of Psalms. Do you know why the Psalms ring so true and bring such comfort to us? Because many of us have experienced the very same sort of trapdoor transitions that David penned into his journal. Events like betrayal, depression, financial reversals, family difficulties, and the consequences of poor personal decisions. David wrote approximately half of the book of Psalms. As a result, you can easily see how the lines of those Hebrew poems weave their way in and out through the events of David's life. In other words, David left tracks. We can follow the trail he walked through the books of Kings and Chronicles. He points us to the faithfulness of God when life knocks us out of the saddle. While still a young man, David tasted difficulty, disappointment, discouragement, and defeat. For a brief season of his life, he had felt the fresh, exhilarating wind on the mountain heights of accomplishment, but he also knew all about those black swamps of depression. David often referred to the path in the Psalms. A path is a trail, as is the Christian life. But fortunately, it is a marked trail. David, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, marked the trail that he was on as he pursued the Lord across the peaks and valleys. That marked trail is recorded for us in the Psalms. And that is why we go so quickly to the book of Psalms when life becomes confusing and difficult. It makes sense, doesn't it? In the pages of the Psalms, we find that the trail has been marked by those who have gone before. And we find ourselves climbing the same hills, staring into the depths of the same starry heavens, and wading through the same murky swamps that David experienced 3,000 years ago. There is a trail. There is a path that God designed ahead of time for you to walk in. He has a plan for you. I know that's just a little difficult to believe sometimes. We get frustrated. We experience major setbacks. We struggle through deep disappointments. We don't like to admit it, but sometimes our hearts get broken. Sometimes we find ourselves stuck in our careers, stuck in our marriages, stuck in the same old personal habits. Quite frankly, at times we feel trapped by circumstances, trapped by our finances, trapped by our failures, trapped because we've hit the ceiling in our careers, and we think there is no escape. I'm thinking of two Christian men who became so overwhelmed by their circumstances that they recently committed suicide. That was their way of dealing with crushing adversity. They decided to pull the trap door on their own lives. Evidently, in their despair and loss of perspective, they decided to take what seemed at the time to be the easy way out. And in doing so, they yanked the floorboards out from under everyone else in their families. They left quite a mess for someone else to clean up. This trail has its ups and downs, and David tracked through every one of them. But you've got to hand it to him. Every time he got knocked down, he got right back up. He didn't stay down. He resisted the urge to quit. He refused the urge to just chuck it all. Before he was 20, David, the future king of Israel, went through two major transitions. The first was your typical rags-to-riches success story. The second was a trap door. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go back to the trailhead and chart David's amazing story from the beginning. David's journey reminds us of a good old poor boy makes the big-time American success story. Only it didn't happen in America, it happened in Israel about 3,000 years ago. At first, the temptation is to think that this story, fascinating and intriguing as it may be, really has no application to or bearing on your life. But making that assumption would be a serious mistake. Unless I miss my guess, this story will speak profoundly and precisely to your personal life and circumstances. David was just minding his own business. The youngest brother of a good-sized clan, he led a life of obscurity and loneliness as he took care of his dad's sheep. David was just a teenager, somewhere between 16 and 20 years old, and had been watching over those woolies for a number of years. As far as he knew, he was going to be a shepherd for the rest of his life. Oh, sure, maybe he'd do a couple-year hitch in the army, but then it would probably be right back to the flocks. It wasn't that bad of a life. The Bible gives no indication that David was discontented with his lot. Every now and then he would have to go one-on-one with a lion or a bear, but other than that, it was a fairly quiet, low-stress lifestyle. Sure, there were lots of times of solitude, but that gave David plenty of time to practice with his slingshot, work on his music, and develop his friendship with the living God. Young men didn't have a lot of options in Israel 3,000 years ago, and realistically, David could look forward to a life of working in the family business and expanding his father Jesse's flock of sheep. Then one day he got word that his father wanted to see him back at the ranch house. He walked in, and there stood his dad, his seven older brothers, and Samuel, the prophet and judge of Israel. That would be like coming home for dinner with the family and finding Billy Graham at your kitchen table, sipping an iced tea in his stocking feet. David took one look at Samuel and knew something was up. And something was up. Before David could get his bearings, he was kneeling before the old prophet with the anointing oil streaming down his face and neck. Samuel told him that God had chosen him to be the next king of Israel. You've heard of sticker shock? This was anointing shock. Who was he that God would reach down and choose him to be king of Israel? He was just a kid, just a simple young shepherd with sheep dung all over his sandals. And God was going to elevate him from a shepherd to a king? That's what you call a major league change. Psalm 78, verses 70 to 71, describe this stunning transition. I quote this verse as rendered in the message. Then he, meaning God, chose David, his servant, handpicked him from his work in the sheep pens. One day he was caring for the ewes and their lambs. The next day God had him shepherding Jacob, his people, Israel, his prized possession. The word that comes to my mind here is transition. You've had some big transitions in your life, and so have I, but going from the sheep pens to the palace is like a missile launch. But here's the catch. This anointing was secret. Saul, of course, was already on the throne as king of Israel and fully inclined to stay there. David was to succeed Saul as king, but the question of when that was supposed to happen hadn't been revealed yet. Until God chose to make it known, knowledge of this anointing of David would remain under lock and key. In spite of the fact that no one other than his family was aware that he had been chosen to be the next king of Israel, David's life began an immediate transition. King Saul was being tormented by evil spirits because the Spirit of God had left him, and the only thing that would soothe him was music. Someone in his inner circle, who was probably anxious for Saul to mellow out, mentioned that there was a shepherd kid in Bethlehem who played a pretty mean harp. And that's when Saul, completely unaware of the fact that Jesse's youngest son was God's hand-picked successor for his job, summoned David to a gig down in the king's private quarters. David went back and forth from his home in Bethlehem to play music for Saul. He was the court musician, and before long, he was promoted again to be Saul's armor-bearer. That was quite an opportunity for a teenage kid from the hill country. But not long after that, something else developed that would change David's life forever. Jesse told David to take some food to his brothers who were in the Israeli army and see how they were doing. As David approached their camp, his eyes fell on the biggest man he had ever seen in his entire life over on the other side of a ravine. It was Goliath, belching out challenges to the Jews to come and fight him, mocking and blaspheming them and their God. Well, you know the rest of the story. David was incensed by this huge goon who had intimidated the army of Israel and slurred the name of God. David went out to confront him, and with one well-placed stone from his sling, Goliath was permanently out of the picture. Saul was thrilled that this monster Philistine had been defeated and beheaded by David. Out of gratitude, he gave his daughter Michal to be David's wife. After that, there was no stopping David's rise to fame. Soon, the former shepherd was leading 1,000 men into battle, enjoying such phenomenal military success that all Israel was singing his praises. So far, so good. This kid was on a roll. In a very short period of time, he had racked up some major successes. Life was good. He had gone very quickly from the pasture to the inner circle of Israel's elite. He was married to the king's daughter, enjoyed the favor of all the people, and seemed to be on the fast track to success. The Bible declares, in everything he did, he had great success because the Lord was with him. That's 1 Samuel 18, verse 14. Overnight, he had become a national hero. They were even writing songs about him. And that is the particular moment when the trapdoor opened without warning beneath David's sandals and everything came crashing down. When King Saul heard that the people were singing, "Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands," he lost it. The king went into a jealous, insane rage and tried to kill David with his spear. And from then on, and for many weary years to follow, David would be a man on the run. David was a fugitive for the next 10, maybe 12 years of his life. Yes, he was eventually going to replace Saul, but he wouldn't realize that promotion for a long, long time. He'd had a small taste of life in the palace. He had sampled the fine wine and enjoyed the great dinners and privileges. For a kid who was used to hanging out with sheep, that was quite a transition. But that transition was nothing compared to the transition that occurred when Saul sprung the trap door and threw David into an era of great personal pain and darkness. Trouble and heartache roared into David's life like a flood. In short order, he lost his job, was driven from his wife and home, was separated from his best friend, and was forced to flee to the wilderness for his very life. The same army he had previously led in triumph only a few months earlier was now pursuing him as public enemy number one. David lived the life of a fugitive constantly on the move, constantly in danger of capture and execution, running from one place to the next, hiding in lonely forest, or lurking in limestone caves. That long chapter of David's life was filled with fear, anxiety, and the constant danger that he would be found and killed. In other words, when the bottom dropped out under David's feet, he was in a free fall for a long, long time. That's what a trap door can do to you. Are you enjoying a season of success right now? Well, that's great. Thank the Lord for that. But here's a word of caution about your success. Don't count on it. Don't bank on it. And above all, don't trust in it. It could be gone tomorrow. Just ask David. You need something greater and bigger than success to build your life upon. The Bible never uses the word trapdoor, but it does use the word pit. And that term pit is very, very appropriate. For when a trapdoor is suddenly sprung beneath you, you find yourself taking an unplanned swan dive governed only by the law of gravity. Shocked, stunned, and out of control, you're headed down like a wounded P-51 in a World War II dogfight. And where will you land? Well, you will land in the pit. That's where young Joseph landed when his older brothers pulled the trap door on his life. When the bottom dropped out of Job's life, he too was headed for the pit. Jonah, in his refusal to obey the Lord's clear direction, he wound up in a semi-liquid pit. The weeping prophet Jeremiah called out to the Lord from the lowest pit. At one point, the prophet was in the pit, literally up to his armpits. It was not uncommon in Old Testament days for a man to dig a pit for the express purpose of trapping his enemy, covering up the hole with brush and dirt for camouflage. Often they would stretch a net on the floor of the pit and up along the walls with the top ends well hidden under the brush. If the man who built the pit was successful, it would trap his enemy and render him helpless. When his captors came to get him, they would just simply pull him up in the net. Here's a short sampling of some pit verses. Psalm 7:15 says, "He has dug a pit and hollowed it out and has fallen into the hole which he has made." Psalm 9:15, "That nations have sunk down in the pit which they have made, in the net which they hid, their own foot has been caught." Proverbs 26:27 says, "He who digs a pit will fall into it, and he who rolls a stone, it will come back on him." Proverbs 28:10, "He who leads the upright astray in an evil way will himself fall into his own pit, but the blameless will inherit good." And then Ecclesiastes 10:8 says, "He who digs a pit may fall into it, and a serpent may bite him who breaks through a wall." The pits were the Old Testament equivalent of a trap door. You've heard the term pitfall? Well, it comes right out of the Old Testament. If the pit was dug and camouflaged successfully, someone was going to fall into that pit. When Saul pulled the lever on that trap door that lunged David out of the palace for the next 10 or 12 years of his life, it looked to some outsiders like God had abandoned David. but nothing could have been further from the truth. For over 10 years, Saul had an all-points bulletin out on David. Saul had his intelligence network and his undercover informants looking for David from one end of the country to the other. David was a fugitive with a price on his head. And this was no TV show or movie. This was real life. Amazingly enough, David took time to write at least 3 magnificent psalms while he was on the run from Saul. He penned these heartfelt songs while hiding in the caves and the surrounding wilderness. Psalms 54, 57, and 63 specifically speak of his time running from Saul. In Psalm 57, 6, David states very clearly that Saul is trying to force him into the pit. David was already in a pit of desperate and difficult circumstances, but Saul was trying to force him into a snare that could cost him his life. Thousands of soldiers were scouring the hills, canyons, and caves looking for the former war hero, and it was all David could do to keep a step ahead of them. They were absolutely hell-bent on killing him. When you're hiding out in the caves, as David was, you are literally in the pit. It just happens to be horizontal instead of vertical. But no matter what shape of a pit you're in, no matter what the particular configurations of the hole in which you find yourself, the question that is always simmering on the back burner of your mind is, how will I ever get out of this? Or to put it another way, how will I ever get through this? When we find ourselves in our own personal pits, when we find the heat of adversity beginning to sear us to the melting point, the issue is always getting through. Pits don't all look the same. Everyone's pit is a little different. Some pits are in a hospital. Your wife or your child is in a bed surrounded by IVs, tubes, and monitors. Like the guy I talked to last week on the West Coast whose 5-year-old son has brain cancer. One day he had a healthy, energetic little boy, and the next day the bottom dropped out. And that trap door transitioned his family right into a hospital. As he sits in that room night after night praying for his son, I'm sure he wonders quite often, how in the world will we ever get through this? Or the guy in his late 40s who had successfully climbed the professional ladder in his career. He's got 2 kids in college, he's got a big mortgage, and enough financial pressure on his shoulders to flatten a Sherman tank. And last month, he was laid off, along with 6,000 of his coworkers. Another trapdoor transition. 2 years ago, his stock options were climbing into the wild blue like an F-16. But now they've got about as much value as a collapsed tent. He's made all the phone calls and pulled all the strings, but nobody's hiring. And at 3 o'clock in the morning, nearly every morning, while his wife and kids are sleeping, he's wondering, how will I ever get through this? Another guy's wife just left him for a man she met over the internet. She's walking out on him and the 3 kids. She's leaving for La La Land, and her family is in free fall. All sense of security and trust scattered like leaves in the wind. And her husband is asking, how in the world will I ever get through this? Theodore Roosevelt was one of the greatest presidents in American history. He was a man who passionately loved God, loved the Bible, and loved his country. He had the vision to cut a canal through the Isthmus of Panama and the guts to lead a charge up San Juan Hill. He had many accomplishments and victories, but he also experienced numerous trapdoors that put him in the pit. On what should have been the greatest night of his life, soon thereafter, tragedy struck. His wife was about to deliver a beautiful baby girl. And deliver the baby she did. And as Roosevelt held that beautiful little girl in his arms, he couldn't believe how blessed and how happy he was to have this beautiful little child entrusted to him. But as he held that baby, his wife was struggling in the bedroom. Complications had arisen. And his mother, who was in a room in the same house, another room, another bedroom, who had been struggling with a cold, she too suddenly developed complications. And for the next 24 to 36 hours, Theodore Roosevelt, in between holding his new baby, would go back and forth between the 2 bedrooms of his wife and his mother, the 2 women he loved more than any other women on the face of the earth. 24 hours later, after struggling with an infection, his mother died, and he was stunned. She had cared for him and loved him all of his life. He had gone from the joys of birth to the throes of death, and his wife was still struggling upstairs. Approximately 12 hours later, the love of his life, his young 22-year-old wife, died. It was a horrible trapdoor. It was a horrible transition. Theodore Roosevelt was presented.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.